procuring something from your vendors, then you need to, you have accounts payable. You have to pay them back for whatever you procured from them. And if you have sold something to the customer, then you have to basically receive the funds from the customer. So that is your account receivable. So this complex web of functions which are there in your in a particular business, they have to be very integrated and they have to communicate with each other very effectively. If you do not have a mechanism where they all see the right information, right time, real time, then there will be disconnects and there will be wrong decisions taken. So just assume that, let's say the sales department is getting some feedback from the market that there is a demand of, let's say, 1 lakh cars. Right? If the sales department does not communicate this properly to warehouse or to production department, then what will happen? If the inventory is less, then the customers will, be very frustrated that, what they want to buy is not available in the market, and they will try to move to some other some other competitor. On the other hand, if, as I said, that, if sales department is the demand is of 1,000 cars and somehow the inventory department and the production department gets the information that, oh, I need to manufacture 1 lakh cars, then there is nobody to buy that, right? So this information sharing is very important, and that is the backbone of the ERP. ERP is the short form for enterprise resource planning. What exactly this ERP does is it's a integrated software which basically brings all the business functions of an enterprise together so that they communicate with each other very effectively and real time. This means that the information that is shared across the platform is available and it is accurate to everyone who sees that. Right? So if the sales department sees that this is the demand, the same demand can be seen by the production department also. It is not like, sales department will see some other demand and production department will see some other demand. Right? So they all see the exact same information, and that is the backbone. If you do not have this, then as I mentioned, that you will have problems operating your business. Either you will lose your market to your competitors, or you will basically face financial challenges in operating your business, because you will have underutilized inventory or overutilized inventory, things like that. Okay. So coming to the theoretical portion, so I've just kept few things over here. These are, standard definitions, and I'll just try to go over a little bit. These are the same definitions you will find in any textbook also, or, even if you will Google what ERP is, you will find the same thing. So as I mentioned, ERP refers to a type of software that organizations use to manage day-to-day business activities, such as accounting, procurement, project management, risk management and compliance, and supply chain operations. A complete ERP suite also includes enterprise performance management. That is a software that helps plan, budget, predict, and report on an organization's financial results. So, as I mentioned, that this is not only about the fact that you are just seeing what the information is in the system. The important factor is that you can also predict that, because it's not that always you will know that what the demand in the market is, right? So the ERP also provides you tools by which you can look at the historical data. Let's say, for example, the festive season during the Diwali time, if you're selling something which is, let's say sweets, and I'm taking, common life examples, may not be really applicable, but just assume that, it is the Diwali time, and you are a manufacturing company which produces sweets or snacks like, Haldiram. So, based on your sales, if you look at your sales figures in the last 2 or 3 years during the Diwali time, you can understand and predict that what your sales is going to be. And based on that prediction, you have to do the manufacturing well in advance. It's not that, like 1 month before the Diwali, your dealers start telling you that, oh, I need this much, this much, this much, and then you start manufacturing. That is not the right thing, right? So that is what the planning and budgeting and prediction, that is what also ERP system supports. These systems tie together a multitude of business processes and enable the flow of data between them by collecting an organization's shared transaction data from multiple sources. ERP systems eliminate data duplication and provide data integrity with a single source of truth. This is a very important factor, as I mentioned, that the data integrity and the transactional consistency is very important. This means that anybody in the system, anybody in the whole organization, if they are seeing something in the system, like, you know, you want to say, see that what is my sales forecast for the next month, everybody in the organization, any department, they will see exact same information. And the other thing is, let's say you have manufactured 1,000 cars, and now those 1,000 cars are added to your warehouse, which is your inventory. So the sales department will also see that there are 1,000 cars available in the inventory. The finance department will also see that they have 1,000 cars in their finished goods, right? So that transactional consistency is ensured by ERP, so that everybody is seeing the consistent information. There is no way the inventory is saying that there are 1,000 cars available in warehouse, and sales department sees that there are 10,000 cars. That is not possible. It is 100% accurate. That is what the ERP system ensures. And today, ERP systems are critical for managing thousands of businesses of all sizes in all industries. And to these companies, ERP is an indispensable as electricity that keeps the lights on, right? So all over the world, any industry, and we'll talk about SAP, but if we talk about in general the ERP concept, any industry anywhere in the world, they are now using one or the other type of ERP. Okay, and and you can relate to the fact that the examples which I gave, where you have to communicate between departments, just assume that if you are a multinational organization where you have plants across the world, and within the country in multiple cities, how exactly that communication will happen, right? So that is why ERP is very important for running the business. So ERP runs on enterprise architecture principle. And why exactly enterprise architecture is important? So numerous disparate information systems. So when you interact with your customers or your vendors, they will have their own systems. Let's say, and if you talk about end user customer, let's say if I go and to buy a car, I'm an individual customer. But assume that you are talking about a business to business dealing. Right, one company is buying something from another company. Let's say Maruti is buying some spare parts from another company, right? So that dealing is very complex, because the other company which you are dealing with, they might be using different systems. They might be using SAP or they might be using some other ERP. So, and within the same company also, there will be some kind of softwares which will be running your shop floor, because the manufacturing department, the production department, would have machines and those machines would be producing some other data, and for that there would be different types of systems being used. So integrating the data becomes very costly. It consumes time, money, and resources. Just assume the examples which I give. If you have to do that manually by paperwork or by phone calls, how many people will be needed? How much money and time you will be spending about that, right? And then there is a risk of inconsistency and duplication of data. If you are talking about word of mouth or some handwritten notes or things like that, there is always a chance of manual error, which will basically cost you dearly if you are, because it can impact your business. Lack of timely information to make decisions. If let's say you are in the sales department and somebody calls you that I want this product, if you do not have the information whether that product is available or not, or when exactly this would be available, what will happen to your customers? You will lose your customers, right? So not only when you are talking about customer interfacing, it's not only important that you tell that, oh, I have this product available, this is the price, etc. If it is not available, you need to give a commitment to the customer that this is the latest by when this product can be available. And then what this all will result in, as I mentioned, it would result in dissatisfied customer and loss of competitiveness in business. If you are not able to satisfy customer demands, they will move to somebody else, right? So that is why this whole ERP concept, this will basically make you more competitive in the market. What are the benefits of ERP? Improved business insight, so real-time accurate information of all aspects of the business. Everybody sees the same information, and everybody sees that same information real-time and accurately. Lower operational cost, streamlined business process, integrated systems, best practices of industry, and faster and cheaper. Let's say you are opening your own company, right? You do not know how to operate the company clearly. And what the ERP systems also provide you is, it provides you the best practices of the industry. Because let's say if there is a big company like Maruti, whatever type of businesses process, the best practices that they are following, how do they predict their demand, how do they manage their inventory, how do they manage their financials, all those best practices are encompassed out of the box in the ERP systems. So if you are opening a new company, you do not need to really learn those businesses. You can just use the best practices which the ERP delivers you, and you can operate your business very easily. And lastly, it is faster and cheaper. When we say it's faster and cheaper, it is in comparison to if you were doing this manually, and the issues that you will face. So basically, the return on investment, like if you are implementing an ERP system, it will of course cost you something to implement that, but that investment that you do for implementing ERP and the result that you will see in your sales, your return on investment is quite high. Enhanced collaboration, information sharing within different functions of business, as I already explained, improved efficiency, common user experience, and higher adoption. So because it is a single interface, single software, everybody in the whole company, every department sees the exact same type of interface, right? So in terms of training, in terms of user adoption, it is very easy, right? Because everybody in the whole organization will have a common user experience. Reduced risk. Eliminates the duplication, discontinuity, and redundancy in data, and data integrity is guaranteed. So as I mentioned, everybody sees the correct, integrated information, correct information, real-time information, and also everybody sees the information based on transactional consistency. That means if you are posting something in your inventory, in your warehouse, then sales also will see the exact same information, finance also will see the exact same information. The result is satisfied past partners and customers, and reducing the required manpower. Today's IT environment challenges. Why exactly we need to do all these things? Because the overall business system is very complex now, right? It is no longer your corner mohalla shop where you are just doing the business with certain customers. Even if you talk about your local ration stores, you know that they are doing business with Amazon and companies like that. So and they might be selling not only in India, they might be selling across the world. Right. So the business, which was there 15, 20 years back is that business environment is completely changed now. Right. People are the markets are very open. So you are producing somewhere, sourcing from somewhere, delivering somewhere. Right. So sitting in India, you might be sourcing something from, let's say, China, and then, manufacturing in India, or, manufacturing some components in Bangladesh and selling in United States. Right. So when you have dealings with such a widespread of your partners, your business partners, the overall system which you use for governing your business or controlling your business becomes very complex, right? You have many partners, customers, and suppliers. You have remote offices, mobile users, local users. And then you have a complex set of information systems, which would have web applications, data centers, files, etc. So the challenges are basically from the fact that many different hardware platforms, everybody that you are dealing with in your business partners, they might be using different source system, different systems, which are on different hardware platforms, which result into compatibility issues. Many different applications. So if you are running SAP and you want to do a business with a customer who is running, let's say, a ERP, which is on Oracle, right? So both of those ERP systems should be able to should be compatible, and they should be certified to communicate with each other, right? So that also results into more complications. Application updates. So because of the fact there are new changes happening in the business environment, the softwares also have to be updated. And when you update them for any kind of new requirements, let's say you are running an ERP which has a tax system, and now GST tax is introduced, which basically changes the complete structure of how you were doing your taxes. So now what you need to do, you need to, your software vendor like SAP, they might do some, release some packages or which you need to install to basically use that new feature of GST. But because of these type of things which are constantly changing, you need to update your applications, and that basically results in cost. Application distribution, you have to deal with multiple users across the globe. So you have to distribute the applications and that there is a user experience related problems with respect to that. And lastly, as I mentioned, operating system and application patching, which requires downtime. When you are trying to do something, let's say a security threat is identified in the software and your software vendor like SAP, they release a patch to you saying that you have to implement this patch or apply this patch urgently. And that requires a downtime of your ERP system. That impacts your business because, there are many industries which operates 24/7. There is not even a 1 minute shutdown, right? So that's why it basically becomes very complex to manage your business and also the ERP systems. So now coming on to SAP. What exactly SAP is? First of all, SAP is a company and their product name is also SAP. SAP stands for Systems, Applications and Products in Data Processing. This is a German company and it is almost like 40, 50 years or more than that old. One thing to call out is that, many a times you will hear people referring to SAP as SAP or, SAP or something like that. I would say that never refer to it like that. It is called SAP and it should be pronounced as SAP only. In fact, long time back, I met some German professionals and this is around 15 years back when I started my career and I started working in SAP. I was working with some Germans who were actually the product experts. And that time, we also used to call that as SAP. Oh, I'm working in SAP FI or I'm working in SAP sales and distribution. They told me that if you are calling SAP as SAP, you are basically telling you don't know anything about SAP, right? So just like you won't call IIT as EAT, same way you should not call SAP as SAP, okay? Next thing about a brief history about SAP. So this company was founded in 1972 by five people. And then it was renamed in 1977. The name before 1977 was Systems Analysis and Product Program Development, but later on they changed it to Systems, Applications and Products in Data Processing, and short form is SAP. As I mentioned, SAP is both the name of the product company as well as their ERP product. This ERP comprises a number of fully integrated modules which covers virtually every aspect of the business. So we'll talk about what modules are in the upcoming slides, but basically these are like small portions or chunks of the overall business which you can choose and implement. It's not necessary that when you implement SAP, then you are implementing everything, right? You can only implement finance of SAP. You can only implement customer relationship management of SAP, things like that. And during this course of many years, SAP basically developed three types of systems, R1, R2, and R3. I'll talk a little bit about what these R1, R2, and R3 are. And as of today, 80% of the Fortune 500 companies use SAP. Now, as I mentioned that, because you can selectively implement SAP, it's not that every company is using SAP like to run their complete business. There are some other ERP products, which I will talk about shortly. There are some other ERP products which are specialized in specific business functions, right? And they basically compete with SAP. And nowadays, you will find a lot of organizations, they will use SAP as their core ERP product for major of their functions, but they will use another ERP product for a specific set of functions. Okay. So these are a few of the other ERP softwares: BAN, JD Edwards, Exceed, Siebel, Oracle, Aramco, Microsoft, Navision, and PeopleSoft. So for example, PeopleSoft is industry leader ERP in the human capital management. So if you're talking about implementing an ERP product for HR solutions like payrolls, employee life cycle, recruitment, things like that, PeopleSoft is the industry leader for that. There is like Salesforce, you might have heard of, it's called Salesforce or Salesforce.com. They are industry leader nowadays in their sales or customer relationship management offerings, right? So because of these facts that, there are some ERPs which are specially focused and specialized in specific business functions, most of the companies now do, multiple implementations of ERPs. And because of this competitive environment, all of these ERPs are very compatible nowadays. So you can have a PeopleSoft implemented for your HR solutions, And you have your SAP for, let's say, your finance, where you have to post your payroll related data. So PeopleSoft and SAP, they are compatible with each other, and they can seamlessly communicate with each other nowadays, right? So that's why the companies are open with and doing this multiple ERP implementations nowadays. Worldwide ERP market share, and this is old data, but it still holds true in the same similar fashion. So you see that SAP alone is the market leader in the ERP market share in the whole world. Within India also, it's the same story. So there are other softwares also, and for example, Oracle, if you talk about, they are leader in the banking industry. So you will rarely find, although SAP has its own banking product also, but you will rarely find SAP being used as a banking software in India. It's everywhere otherwise Oracle Financials, which is Oracle's, key product in the banking sectors. And within India, there are like 2,500 plus installations. Overall, in the world globally, there are 76,000 installations of SAP in 120 plus countries. This is about evolution of SAP products. So, first of all, they had R1, then they had R2, and then the first product they came up, which was the main product, was R3. And then they started, enhancing or making, improving that product. They made it as R3 Enterprise, which was web enabled. And then they came up with MySAP ERP. And then they started with advanced solutions like CRM, which is customer relationship management, SCM, supplier, supply chain management, PLM, product lifecycle management, and all. And finally, now the product which we have, the main product, is called MySAP Business Suite. And the latest product which SAP has now, which was launched 2-3 years back, is called S4 HANA, or it's called simply as S4. Why exactly SAP architecture is referred to as R3? Because the technical architecture of how this software is built is comprised of three levels of servers. There is a presentation server, application server, and database servers, right? Database server is responsible for storing your data. Application server is where your, the complete business logic, your code, or your application is running. And presentation layer is basically what you are seeing on your laptop or, on your phone, or et cetera. So that's why there are three levels of servers, and that's why it is called as three-tier architecture and referred to as R3. So this is an example, diagram of how exactly the system architecture is set up. Before this R3 architecture, there was R1 and R2. The difference was, in R1, there was only one server where you were storing your data, where you were running your application, and which is what was showing you the front-end screen or the user interface. And then came the R2. Where you are basically, you moved your presentation layer separately, but your application and database were running on a single server. And then this came this R3 system. What is the benefit of R3 system? You can basically scale up your system very easily. If you, let's say, the amount of data that you want to store has grown tremendously, you are doing a lot of business, so you want to increase the memory size of your database, so you can increase the number of database servers. If you are doing more complex processing, you have very large amount of business applications running, you want to increase the number of application servers, you can do that. And same way for presentation layer also, you can increase the number of clients to as much as you want. So there is this flexibility that if you are making your business bigger, you are growing your business, you can actually increase or scale up any of these layers. And that is the main benefit of having the R3 architecture. Why exactly ERP has been so successful? So it is multilingual. So when you are operating in multiple countries, you have to basically take care of language requirements. Because if you're dealing, let's say, with China, in China, your suppliers will want to see your invoices, etc., in Chinese language. Whereas in India, you will want to see that in English or so. So this multilingual requirement is very well managed by SAP. It supports all major languages in the world. The information is secure. The whole environment is very integrated, enterprise-wide. It provides you best business practices from across the world, and then it also supports multi-currency. So again, the same thing when you're operating with a business in multiple countries, you have to deal in multiple currencies as well. So that is also out of the box supported by SAP. Real-time processing with an integrated suite of client and server applications. It's very open, fully integrated business processes, modular structure. And this modular structure is what we will talk about shortly. It's international product, but it is consistent. So even if you are doing business with anywhere in the world, and if your suppliers and your vendors or your customers are using SAP, the process or this software's look and feel and, you know, working way will be exactly consistent. Right? And then it provides you best practices across the industries and models. So whether you are, like, for example, in an industry which is make to order versus a make to stock, the software application of ERP and SAP provides you exact same functionality with the best practices to run that type of business. Providing maximum flexibility and scalability, strong backbone for future technology, and then OSS 24-hour support available. OSS support is the SAP support. So if you have any problem with your product, if there is any issue coming, there is a 24-hour support provided by SAP for running this application. Now coming to the modules, right? So I was talking about in the previous slide about modular structure. So modular structure means that SAP has basically, structured its overall ERP by modules. And you can selectively choose and implement whichever module you want to, right? It's not necessary that you have to implement everything. These are the core modules of SAP. ERP, which is R3 modules. Apart from this, there are advanced modules as well, which we'll talk a little bit about. But these are the core modules that you will need to understand or know about. Financial accounting, controlling, asset management, human capital management, workflows, project system, warehouse management, plant maintenance, quality management, production planning, materials management, and sales and distribution. So you can select any of these and implement in your company, or you can select one, you can select five, or any number of modules you want to implement. And then there are SAP's industry specific products. So there are, although like manufacturing or finance, HR, these things are very common. So every industry, whether you're talking about FMCG company or you're talking about automobile company, they will have pretty much same processes in your manufacturing, in your sales, in your HR, etc. But there are some specific things which are very specific to industry. So for that, SAP has their industry specific solutions, which are in addition to the core modules that you saw. So this is a list of some of the industry-specific solutions, vertical solutions, which are available with SAP, like for aerospace, defense, media, automotive, things like that, even for insurance and utilities. So what is done in the SAP implementation projects? So whatever I talked about right now, more or less theoretical, right? You can basically read about those things on Google also, and there are tons of YouTube videos and tons of material online available, which you can see and learn that what exactly SAP is and how to use that. So here I'll just try to talk a little bit about what do we do in SAP consulting, right? And I have been in SAP consulting for 15 years. So whenever we go to a new project, like, we go to a new client and we have to implement SAP, what exactly we do? Right? And this is important. If you want to build a career in SAP consulting, then you will basically need to understand that what will be your role, what kind of, where exactly you will fit in that job. So let's say you are going to a new company which is not using SAP today, right? They are using some old system, or even let's say they are doing their business on books, right? They are manually writing in Khata books, or books like that, and now they want to move to SAP. So first of all, the first thing that you need to do is to study their current business processes, what exactly they do, how they are running their business, right? And being business administration graduates and postgraduates, you guys, you will be key to understand this, because when we say that study what is the legacy process and then document that this is how the business is being operated, this work is done by business analysts, which are usually business graduates or postgraduates. They are BBAs or MBAs, right? So we will go and study how they are currently running their business. Then we also analyze the legacy applications or systems being used. I mean, I gave example that let's say a business is running on all books or manually, but that is very rare. Even small companies nowadays, they use some kind of software, might be some smaller, you know, software here and there. They might not be using an integrated ERP, but they might be using as one software for sales, one different software for manufacturing, things like that. So as part of this, these projects, we also go and study that how, what systems are being used and how exactly those systems are operating and communicating with each other. Then we define a template for SAP. So based on what type of industry you are going to, let's say you are going to a consumer goods industry. So based on that, we will define a template for SAP. What is the defining the template means? Defining the template means that, you know, what, how many company codes are there? How many plants are there? What is the chart of accounts? How many GL accounts we will create? What are my profit centers? What are my cost centers? What are my customers? What are my materials? What are my vendors? All of those things are basically coming to your configuration of standard SAP product and defining the template. That is where you will define which countries you will operate in, what are your currencies that you want to operate in, what is the languages that you want to operate in. All of that part is part of the defining template and the configuration of the standard SAP product. Then we do the customization of the SAP product based on the customer specific business processes. So let's say when you are, you know, the standard SAP provides you a transaction to create a sales order. And when you create a sales order, you are, you know, the standard software allows you to put the customer name, you know, the customer number, the material number, the quantity, things like that. Right? Or where, which plant or warehouse it would be picked up from, how it would be delivered, things like that. Those are the key functionalities which SAP standard product will provide you. But let's say the customer has a specific requirement to mention something additional, which is not available as a, you know, entry field in SAP. For that, we do customization of the SAP product. We will enable some additional processes or et cetera, et cetera. And that is what the customization part, which is done in the SAP projects. Once all this is done, we basically do the dry run and test the solution. What does dry run meaning? Dry run meaning is that either you manually enter the data in the system, or you basically do the migration of the data from the existing legacy systems into the SAP test system. You will bring everything into your target SAP system from the legacy systems, and you do the overall testing of the solution. You will try to create new sales orders. You will try to create new purchase orders. You know, you will try to create new production orders, post in your inventory, post in your financials, things like that. So you do the testing of the overall solution from every department's perspective, do the training of the users. And then finally, when you are ready for the go live, you will prepare your production system, load and set up all the master data, bring the legacy data. So when we do the migration and you know, going ready for the go live, we in fact also bring the running sales order. Let's say, you know, you created a sales order today in the system, that sales order will also be brought into the new system, new SAP system. And once everything is available in your target system, that is where you do a go live of your, you know, ERP system. And then post that, it would be support. So this is the overall high level of things that we do in the implementation projects. And if you think about from your perspective that where exactly you will fit in, if you are domain expert, like, you know, you are expert in procurement. You have, you know, let's say you have worked in a company where the in the procurement department. So you understand how the overall procurement process works, right? If you're a domain expert, you can work in a company in that procurement department, which is using SAP, and be as a user, SAP user, where you will be using SAP as a procurement user, right? Or if you have a good amount of domain expertise, then you can join SAP consulting also after doing some training, formal training and certification in SAP. And then you can join an SAP consulting company where you can work in, let's say, as a SAP procurement expert or SAP, you know, finance expert, things like that. I'm just checking time. So this is on a high level, you know, some details about the core functionalities of the modules of SAP. So we have materials management module, which is basically, which takes care of your procurement, etc. It includes material procurement, inventory management, batch management, goods inspection and invoice verification, etc. Then you have production planning module. where basically you define your bill of materials. Bill of materials is the recipe for your manufacturing something like, you know, I want to manufacture a toothpaste. So for manufacturing toothpaste, I need these 10 items. And then that is what your bill of materials is. Also, it supports MRP, which is material resource planning. What are the, like, you need to plan what are the raw materials you need for manufacturing, right? That is what MRP is. MRP is an integrated process which basically pulls the data from your sales, pulls the data from your inventory, and pulls the data from your finance. And based on that, it basically predicts that what is the amount of raw materials which I'm going to require, right? And so that I can procure them, right? Then creation of production orders, quality management in production. Those are the things which are taken care of by the PP module. Then sales and distribution. This is the main one of the main modules of SAP, where basically it basically takes care of the complete sales process. Creation of like inquiry, creation of sales orders, creation of shipment, delivery, billing, everything. Finance is basically the one which receives the data from everywhere. So here you have general ledger, where you will basically have accounts payable, accounts receivable, and cash management. Accounts payable is what you have to pay to your vendors. Accounts receivable is what you have to receive from your customers. And then also, you know, your inventory valuation, your material valuation, everything is taken care of in the finance, including, let's say, your payroll, salaries, things like that as well. Controlling does the cost center accounting, product costing, and order contribution analysis. And then these are a few things about, you know, some of the key functions of each of these modules. So let's say financial accounting, it basically takes care of your external reporting of general ledger. Like if you're a limited company, then you have to publish your, you know, P&L statement, your, external statements like that, right? So for that, the ERP software provides you the automated functionality by which you can pull your, you know, balance sheets and your P&L statements. Manage your accounts receivable, payable, and subledger accounts. Key elements of FI are general ledger, accounts payable, receivable, asset management, legal consolidation, and accounting information systems. This is just a graphical diagram which is displaying the details of how the financial accounting module is linked with each other. Then you have controlling. Basically, here you control your cost and revenue. So you will do your cost center accounting, profit center accounting, product costing, etc. Like you want to know what should be the cost of the product that you are going to sell. So for that, you need to take care of what are the costs that you are incurring in manufacturing that product, in shipping that product, delivering that product. And based on all that, you have to decide your cost, the product's cost, so that you will have profit. So all of those things are supported by the controlling module. Sales and distribution, as I mentioned, this takes care of the complete sales cycle, starting from sales, then delivery, and then billing. Also, credit management and warehouse management, etc. So, high-level diagram of how exactly the sales process works. So, you get the sales inquiry, provide quotations, and then once all that is done, either you will create a contract or you will create a sales order. Based on that, you will deliver. After the delivery is done, then you will generate invoice or debit or credit memo, things like that. Materials management, we already talked about that. It is primarily responsible for doing taking care of procurement and inventory. Here we are showing the details of some of the components of the materials management, what you do in purchasing or inventory management or invoice verification, things like that. Production planning, as I mentioned, that for taking care of all your manufacturing activities, your bill of materials, your routings, work centers, and we also do the sales and operations planning. I'm sure that you might have heard about this concept. Again, this is in line with how much you have to produce, depending on what your demand is, etc. So that is what your S&OP is. And these are a few things about the production planning. So what exactly you do in terms of the overall process, like what you need to manufacture. You need to get some details from sales department. You need to interact with the procurement department for raw materials. Then you have a PM module, which is plant maintenance module, that takes care of your maintenance, repairs, etc. Like if you have a machine that is broken, So there is a module in SAP which is plant maintenance that will take care of creating maintenance orders to get repair of your machines, right? And then quality management module, which is QM module, that is to take care of your inspections and certifications to your finished goods. So this is what we are talking about, the quality management. Here we do the inspections. We plan for the quality and then do the quality, control the quality of the manufacturing. Project systems, this is a specific module if you are running projects, enterprise projects. So managing your project financials and, you know, tracking the activities, monitoring them and monitoring the success and goals of the project, that is controlled by the project systems module. And then lastly, it is the human capital management module, which basically is for recruitment, payrolls and time management, travel expenses, workforce planning and organization management, etc. And lastly, as I mentioned, career as a SAP professional. So what exactly you can do and where do you fit, right? So either you have to be a domain expert or you have to be a SAP, you know, user or let's say a certified consultant. If you're already having some prior experience in the industry, whether the that is right, that is what you, contribute to your you as a being a domain expert. So if you are with one of those experiences, you can join a company as that expert and work in their SAP department, you know, where you will be working with the SAP consultants to define how the business in SAP will work, right? So as I mentioned that earlier, that to understand what is the how the current business is running in an SAP implementation, there are business analysts, and those business analysts are nothing but they are domain experts. They are experts in let's say manufacturing, so they know how exactly the production works, right? So they will study the current systems or current way of how the business is operating and work with the SAP consultants on making sure they configure the SAP software correctly. Second is SAP user. That is very likely if you work in a, you know, in a company which is using SAP, then most likely you will basically interact with SAP as a user. And lastly, as a SAP certified consultant. So for that, you will need to do some training and certification from SAP. You can become either a technical functional consultant or you can be a business function consultant. Technical functions are like, you know, being analytics expert or security expert. And business functions or modules expert is like, as I mentioned, being a SAP HR certified consultant or SAP sales and distribution certified consultant, things like that. Okay, so these are some of the process flows. I'll just skip these, nothing important here. So let's move on to the Q&A. If you have any question at this point, you can ask.
Dear students, if you have any doubt, please write down in the chat box. Although I know the session was very much informative, there were many new things which I have learned today only from Vikas. Let's talk about the various domains, then career prospects, then the kind of products, R1, R2, R3, and so on. And how you can basically, after all, I have been able to analyze that it is a great career option for management students because it talks about business intelligence and it talks about how business decisions are benefited with the help of this SAP in processing of data and in taking relevant decision. So if still you have any doubts, although it was self-explanatory, you can ask in the chat box. Otherwise, Vikas, it was in some time you have tried to share all the relevant information to the students. I'm very happy and I'm very confident that those who really had keen interest in this field would be able to at least explore the new domains, and surely the value has helped them to uplift their knowledge base. Like theoretically they have studied in logistics management about the concept, but you have helped them to know the insight of the concept with the practical industry relevant examples. I think any doubt, good Nayan, you have asked a question. So anybody who is having any thought coming into mind related to SAP, why SAP for
there
business
is,
management
one
students?
Question which is asked. There is one question asked about how exactly we should study about SAP, right? So this is a very, very good question. So basically, just to begin with, I won't really suggest that you directly go for SAP training and certification. First of all, the reason being it's very expensive, right? So the certification exam, before going to that, you have to make sure that you have studied well. Right. To begin with, what you can do is you can just go and study online. If you do Google and find out, like, you want to get the SAP material for sales and distribution, you will get tons of materials. There are so many presentations available on the web. You can just go through any of the modules that you are interested in and study from there first. Once you are good with the understanding of that, then based on your further level of interest, you can try to find out some institutes which provide SAP training and certification. So you need to do some training first, and then you have to apply for SAP certification and then get yourself certified.
Dear students, I believe Vikas, very nicely you have given answer to this question. Believe me, if you will go with all traditional things, to make a extraordinary career will be a great challenge. So obviously you have to differentiate yourself from rest of the crowd, and digital marketing, SAP, data analytics, then business analytics. These are the upcoming career prospect in the field of management. And I believe, like, if you will hear to people like Vikas, who are having a rich experience of 14, 15 years in these technologies and implementation of these technologies, probably you will be able to at least would understand the concept practically. At least in your interviews, you can connect to the interviewer with the not advanced, at least the basic concept clarity. So any other questions? Sia, you want to say something? I can unmute you. You can ask question. Sia, are you listening to me? Because your request to unmute, I have seen. Anybody else who is asking any question, feel free to write down in chat box better. Yes, Sia, over to you.
नहीं मैम, मुझे कुछ नहीं पूछना.
ओके ओके, बाय मिस्टेक इट वाज केम. ओके फाइन सिया, परफेक्टली फाइन. सो गिनी, यू आर आस्किंग, सर देयर इज अ क्वेश्चन इन चैट बॉक्स. ओके, इट इज प्राइवेटली सेंड टू मी. इज देयर एनी स्पेसिफिक साइट वेयर वी कैन लर्न एंड गेट करेक्ट मटेरियल ऑनलाइन? Would you like to suggest any specific site for this?
You can help.sap.com. This is the SAP's website itself. There itself you will find all the materials.
I think you have got the answer. Sir has written down a site in the chat box where you can get more about SAP, and you can go ahead with it. Okay, sir, thanks is publicly okay. Coming to you. So any other doubt, any other question, please feel free. Then we will close for the day. And I feel those who have attended will be enriched with the experience sharing of Vikas. That's very nice. So I think, Vikas, if there will be still any doubt, we will surely get back to you.
Absolutely.
Thank you so very much, dear students, for being a very good audience, consistently listening to the speaker of the day. And I extend my heartiest thanks to Vikas for sparing his valuable time for my students and enriching them with the basic concept of SAP and the career prospects in this line. And we would be looking forward to connect to you again. Tejasvi, do you have any question? Tejasvi, you can write down in chat box if you have any doubt. If there is no question, please write down no, ma'am, because I have I'm getting a request to unmute. So last but not the least, I fold my both the hands, extend my gratitude and regards to you. And thank you so much.
It was a great opportunity to talk to you all of you guys. I hope that I was able to provide you some important information. All the best for your future career prospects, and you know, be safe in this pandemic. So with that, best wishes to all, and thank you once again.
Thank you. Thank you, dear students. We are signing off for the day. Enjoy your weekend. Be safe and enjoy your learning. Thank you so very much. Goodbye. Stay blessed.